Some things are worth waiting for. Have you heard that before? You heard that? All right. What's worth waiting for? Love. Tax return. Is it? Like, you hit submit, you want it now. Right? In my mind, the people who say that some things are worth waiting for already have the thing that they wanted before. Right? Because I know when I want something, I want it right now. When we got a house a couple years ago, 2 years ago, we bought a house. We had to wait like 60 days for closing, and I wanted to move in right now. Right? When we started to plant this church, we thought about it July 14th, 2014 is when God put this on my heart. And I wanted to plant it like tomorrow. I didn't want to wait. When you want a pizza and they say it'll be here in an hour, like I want it in 20 minutes, right? Because I'm hungry. You get a package from Amazon and it says 4 days. I want it in 2 days. Hashtag Amazon Prime. Who's got a subscription? Come on now. That's right. When I found out that I was going to have a baby, I couldn't wait 9 months. I want that baby right now. That's a lie. I enjoyed every moment of waiting on that baby. Hashtag no judgment. Hashtag so did you. Come on now. I think it's especially true with technology. We don't like to wait. Everything's instant. I remember when I was growing up, it took 45 minutes for the AOL homepage to upload, right? You remember that? And then someone would pick up the phone. You're like, hang up the phone. I'm trying to look at these Backstreet Boy pictures. Come on now. Hang up the phone. And if you wanted to get the score of the game, you had to hit the refresh button, and you got the second quarter score in the fourth quarter, right? That's how it worked. But now everything is so fast-paced, it's ruined our tolerance for patience. So maybe there's something to the adage that some things are worth waiting for, even if we don't believe it. Even if we don't feel that it's valuable or it's worth waiting for, there might be a purpose behind it. In the next few weeks leading up to Easter, we're going through a series called The Road, and that reveals the path that we've taken as human beings being separated from God. Separated from God in the Garden of Eden, and then returning to God in the resurrection on Easter Sunday. So last week we talked about that fracturing event that theologians call the fall that happened in the Garden of Eden where Adam and Eve chose autonomy from God. And we talked about the devastating consequences of that, which we feel every single day. We also talked about the hope that God revealed to them. Even in this moment in Genesis chapter 3 of separation, God revealed grace. God revealed a plan of restoration. The problem is, as you continue to read Genesis chapter 2 and 3 and 4 and 5 and 6 and 7 and on and on and on, there's murder, there's hatred, there's devastation, there's rebellion, there's death, there's evil. And so you don't really see where this restorative plan is at. You're wondering what mechanism God is going to use to bring about restoration. It's in Genesis chapter 12 that we begin to see the story revealed. So, I'm going to have the scripture above me. If anybody would like a Bible, we will give you one. You just raise your hand. You can take it home with you. You can underline, write your name in it, give it to somebody else. Anybody want a Bible? You can have one. Anybody want one? Anybody? Anybody? No one wants the Bible. Very good. We also have the Bible app. If you have the Bible app on your phone, you can go to the Bible app, hit more, search events. Search Altered Church. If you wonder what I do at 2:30 in the morning, it's the Bible app. So starting in chapter 12, I watch Netflix sometimes too, and obscure documentaries. Starting in Genesis chapter 12, we're going to meet this guy Abraham. Some context, Abraham is very wealthy. Abraham has lots of land and influence. Abraham doesn't have any kids. This is a problem. Because in the ancient Near East, your legacy depended on how many children you had. If you had a lot of money but didn't have children to give it away to, that was a problem. So Abraham is wealthy. He's got lots of land and camels and influence, but no kids. It says in chapter 12, verse 1, the Lord had said to Abraham, leave your native country, your relatives, and your father's family, and go to the land that I will show you. Well, that escalated pretty quickly. Because imagine that you're Abraham, and you're just sitting there, and suddenly you hear this voice, and presumably it's God, and you start asking questions. God, you want me to leave my country, this place that I love? You want me to leave my relatives and the people who are in my inner circle? You want me to leave my father's house, the people I'm close with, the people that I trust? And you want me to go to a land which you will show me, like, eventually? Like, when I get there? God, you know I'm rich, right? I'm a big deal, God. I got all sorts of camels, and people do what I tell them to do. I got animals. I got all sorts of stuff. God says, I will make you into a great nation. I will bless you and make you famous. You will be a blessing to others. Now, at this point, Abram is suddenly interested. His ears perk up. Because Abram's childless. He doesn't have any descendants. But God is saying, I'll make you into a great nation. God is saying, I will make you great and you will be well known. I will make your descendants powerful and influential. And more than that, I will bless you. Meaning I will give you prosperity in everything that you do. And then God literally says, I'll make you famous. And who doesn't want that? Everybody wants fame, fortune, recognition, legacy. But more than that, you will be a blessing to others. So if you're Abram, this is getting enticing. At first you were promised things that you already had, but now you're getting promises for things that you don't have, like descendants and legacy. God continues, I will bless those who bless you and curse those who treat you with contempt. All the families on the earth will be blessed through you. So the attitude that God takes towards others will be influenced by how they respond to Abraham. Think of the weight of that. So God has chosen this guy, and really outside of his wealth, he's not special. He's just a guy. And God speaks audibly to him. He tells him to leave behind everything that he knows. And you can bet that Abram is skeptical, because I'd be skeptical. Would you be skeptical? Right? Sure. But God promises land. He promises wealth. He promises influence. He promises blessings. But most importantly, he promises descendants. So Abram departed as the Lord had instructed. And Lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old when he left Haran. So God makes promises to Abram. He believes them and he goes. Now I'm trying to be realistic here. I'm trying to be honest. And if I heard an audible voice telling me to pack my things and leave, I'd probably check myself into a hospital, right? But Abram goes. Why does he go? The key's in verse 4. How old is he? 75 years old. No one is promising a 75-year-old man descendants. So God is promising what is seemingly impossible. God is promising something that couldn't be fulfilled in any other way. But Abram demonstrates a great deal of faith and he leaves. He leaves his home. He goes. The problem is, not much happens for a few years. Abram's family moves and they set up camp and they claim this land, but no kids. So Abram's waiting on the promise, but God seems to be taking his time. Years go by, no kids, no family. He speaks to Abram in chapter 15. The word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Do not be afraid, Abram. I'm your shield. I am your great reward. Abram, your security and identity is found in me. Everything that you hope to accomplish and achieve is found in relationship with me. You want legacy? You want joy? You want little kids running up and down the hallways at church? You want to make an impact through the world? You can do that. And you will do that through me. But Abram said, Sovereign Lord, what can you give me since I remain childless and the one who will inherit my estate is Eliezer of Damascus? And Abram said, You have given me no children. So a servant of my household will be my heir. Abraham is doing that thing where he's kind of fishing, okay? You got a teenager? Anybody got a teenager? Had one? No one? No, they exist? Right, okay. Dad, I want to go to the mall. I got friends and I never see them, Dad, ever. Never seen them. I know what I'm going to do. I'm so lonely. And it'd be so, made me so happy to buy some clothes. Because I hardly have any clothes. My closet is full of clothes, but I don't have any clothes. But I need money. That's fishing. And that's what Abraham's doing. Abram's fishing. But he's also being honest with God. Look, God, you keep saying you're going to bless me. You keep saying you're going to give me some heirs, but I don't have any heirs. I don't have any little kids running up and down the hallways of church. And I'm getting old, God. I'm getting old. And if I die now, all of my wealth will go to a servant. He's not even in my family. God, I'm waiting on a promise, but you haven't shown up. And God says, this man will not be your heir, but a son who is your own flesh and blood will be your heir. Abram, I keep telling you to trust me. I told you, you will have a son. He will be your heir. Let me show you something. Abram, look up at the sky. Count the stars if indeed you can count them. So shall your offspring be. God says, count the stars if you can. By the way, you can't. This is the number of descendants you will have. Abram, you are thinking too small. I told you, I'm your great reward. I am your shield. Abram, you want a single descendant. I'm going to give you millions of descendants. You want a legacy in this time and place. I'm going to give you a legacy that will reign in eternity. Now, I'd be willing to bet that God, he's a pretty good preacher. He's probably the best. And since I'm a preacher too, I'm looking at this scripture like it's God's sermon notes. And this is some pretty incredible stuff here, right? This is that powerful send-off part of the sermon. It's that big moment. So I'm guessing God is really getting into this. And the music starts to play. You know, the music starts to play. And God's like, look at this guy. Do you see the stars? This is your future. You know that part. These are your descendants. And then the music is playing, and the angels are singing, and Abraham's in tears. Abraham's lifting his hands up. He's feeling it. He's never going to forget this moment. He's ready. He's ready to wait on the promise until chapter 16. Now, Sarai, Abram's wife, had bore him no children. But she had an Egyptian slave named Hagar. So she said to Abram, the Lord has kept me from having children. Go sleep with my slave, and perhaps I can build a family through her. Abraham, she doesn't mean that. This is what you would call a test. See, when your wife says, I don't really want anything for Christmas, or I'm not that hungry, just get yourself some food, or Valentine's Day doesn't mean that much to me, this is a test. When she says, oh, just go without me, how do I look in these pants? You pick the movie, you're being tested. So Abram, look, gentlemen, you can clap your hands. You know what I'm talking about. Ladies, don't elbow him. We're in church. Abram's a slow learner. In 85 years, he hasn't figured out basic survival tactics. So Abram agreed to do what Sarai said. Okay. So after Abram had been living in Canaan 10 years, Sarai, his wife, took her Egyptian slave Hagar and gave her to her husband to be his wife. And he slept with her and she conceived. Come on, man. Come on. Predictably, Abram's wife becomes very jealous and angry, and this causes all sorts of disorder and dysfunction and jealousy. And the baby that was born wasn't even a true heir. It was from a concubine. He couldn't even inherit what Abraham had. So it was all for nothing. Why is this happening? God has just reaffirmed his promise. He told Abram that his descendants would be like the stars. But he was tired of waiting on the promise. God said, go, when he left home. He inhabited a new land. He patiently waited for God to give him everything he had promised. And 10 years goes on, but still no son. 10 years goes by, still no heir. So what he's discovering is the promise is initiated through going, but the promise is experienced through growing. Leaving was the easy part. Packing up his bags and all the thrill of emotion and hope and excitement, that's the easy part. Waiting on the promise, learning to live in faith, pressing forward in hope and trusting God, growing in a relationship with God, that's the hard part. The promise is initiated through going. The promise is experienced through growing. Abram wanted to be blessed. God wanted to mold Abram into greatness. Abram wanted to have a child. God wanted Abram to be the father of innumerable descendants. Abram wanted to lead his family. God wanted Abram to be a man who would lead billions and billions of people as a model of faithfulness. Abram was waiting on the promise. God was waiting for Abram to be a man worthy of receiving the promise. So Abram, he'd wait. He'd wait some more. God didn't speak to Abram again for 13 years. 13 years of silence. 13 years of Abram waiting, and now Abram's 99 years old. He's an old man. When Abram was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to him and said, I am God Almighty. Walk before me faithfully and blameless. Then I will make my covenant between me and you, and I will greatly increase your number. Here you go again, God. Here you go again. I'm old, God. You keep talking. And see, if I'm Abram, if this is me, I'd shake my fist. I'd say, God, what's going on? I've been waiting. I left. Where are you? But Abram fell face down. Face down in reverence and worship, not anger or frustration. God hasn't spoken to him in 13 years. He left all he knew behind. He went out in faith. He experienced loss and heartbreak, and yet he responds in reverence and worship. And God says to him, as for me, as far as I can see it, Abram, this is my covenant with you. You will be the father of many nations. No longer will you be called Abram, your name will be Abraham. For I've made you a father of many nations. The promise is repeated. At this time, God gives him a new name, Abraham. The waiting period has come to an end. The going is being rewarded. The growing is being rewarded. And 1 year later, we read about the birth of a baby from the perspective of Abraham's wife. Genesis 21:6. And Sarah said, God has brought me laughter, and everyone who hears about this will laugh with me. And she added, who would have said to Abraham that Sarah would nurse children? Yet I have borne him a son in his old age. The promise fulfilled. When Abraham dies in Genesis chapter 25, he dies knowing that God had fulfilled his promise for descendants and land. Yet he died not really knowing the extent of the promise. Abram's son, his name was Isaac. And Isaac was the father of Jacob. Jacob, also known as Israel, the father of 12 sons. The 12 sons, the father of millions and millions of Jewish people. Abram's son Isaac is one of the most pivotal figures in all of the Bible. His name is mentioned 130 times. The 109th mention of his name is in a genealogy with these words. Abraham was the father of Isaac. Isaac, the father of Jacob. Jacob, the father of Judah and his brothers. And then the genealogy goes on, verse after verse, name after name, descendant after descendant. And it finishes with these words. Jacob, the father of Joseph. Joseph, the husband of Mary. Mary was the mother of Jesus, who was called the Messiah. From Abraham to Isaac, to Jesus. And in this, the promise makes sense. The promise to bless all people of every nation and tribe. The promise to have descendants that outnumber the stars. The promise to have an eternal lineage. All of the promises made to Abraham fulfilled in his descendant, Jesus Christ. Abraham just wanted a legacy of descendants. God gave him a legacy of faithfulness and grace. And this teaches us three things about the promise. Number one, when hope fades, the promises of God endure. If you didn't know already, tragedy will strike your life. You can expect that. Heartbreak will happen in your life. This doesn't change the promise of eternity. It doesn't change the promise of joy. It doesn't change the promise of new life. It's in these moments where you don't see a way out that God is working a way in. Illness, death, despair, moments when you shrink and you don't show up is when God shows up magnified and he's palpable. Moments when you say, I can't, is when God shows up and says, I have and I will. Number two, God is faithful in his promises when we are not. Understand this. Your trust in the promise has nothing to do with the reality of the promise. Because there are moments when you are in despair and you are depressed and lonely and worn out. There are days that you will be convinced that God wants nothing to do with you. But God will still be present. still rejoicing over you, still loving you like he does on your best days. He's not so insecure that he needs you to be fearless or perfect. You see, when you fail, he is unfailing. When you fall, he is upright. When you break every rule, he breaks every chain to bring you back and to restore you. This is the part of the promise that we need the most. But number three is the part that I like the best. Because God's fulfillment of the promise is bigger and more audacious than we could ever have the capacity to hope for. You want things that are small and inconsequential. What you want is so meager and small in comparison to what God has for you. What he has for you are too big for your dreams. Let me show you what I'm talking about. Jared, can you give me Hillsong? Oh, you can't see anything. That's terrible. If you could, you'd see a row of people, and you'd see me sitting at the end of the row. This is the very day, July 14th, 2014, at the very church service in that very seat where God called me to go out and start a new church. A church for everyone. A church that Northeast Ohio has never seen before. And the moment I left the seat that you can't see, the moment I left, I knew I was leaving behind things that felt comfortable and things that felt safe for something I couldn't conceptualize. Something I had no frame of reference for, but I knew God had made me a promise. He promised me that if I gave him all of my passion and all of my energy and all of my trust, he would do greater things than I could ever imagine. Now, that promise was important, especially at first, because there was only about four of us. I didn't know where this church was going to be. I didn't know who would come to this church, but I knew I had a promise. And so then our team grew by a handful. And then we planned and we prayed and we dreamed. We didn't have details, but we had a promise. 18 months later, we rented this building. Jerry, let's see the office building. You can see that one. We started talking about meeting in the basement. Jared, let's get the next picture. You're so good. You're so good, Jared. This was April of 2016 in a basement, no ceiling tiles. There were 20 people. In August 2016, there were 40 people. Now, I wasn't sure how many people would show up because I was told by a man who was an expert sitting across from me from coffee that a church could not be started in Northeast Ohio with more than 100 people. It had never been done before. And all the experts and all the magazines and all the books and all the professors said you couldn't expect a congregation of 100 people for more than 4 years. It doesn't happen. And the churches that did, they had big churches paying their budgets, paying their expenses, networks providing tens of thousands of dollars, large companies providing investments. Well, we didn't have any of that. But we had a few families who were generous and believed in the promise. We didn't have any money. We didn't know who would come. We didn't know if we had any musicians. Aaron, John, I love you, but we didn't know if our worship leader could sing or play the guitar, just so you know. We didn't know if people would love us or hate us. But God called us to do it, and he gave us a promise. On September 18th, 2016, we launched this church with 197 people. And people said that it would shrink. You can't maintain them. That's just your grandma coming. That's just your aunts and your uncles. That's just your neighbors. They like you, but they don't like your church. They're going to leave. But that didn't happen. Over 200 on Christmas Eve, over 100, 200 2 weeks ago, 290 people here at capacity. It says right there, 299. We baptized 24 people. That never happens. The average church can expect to baptize 10 people a year. We're going to baptize 50 here or more this year. And people are seeing love for the first time. People are experiencing community and peace and grace for the first time. We didn't expect this. We didn't count on this. We didn't even have the audacity to ask for it. But we did have a promise. What you're feeling and what you're seeing is the promise and action. But let me tell you, the promise hasn't even started. The fulfillment hasn't even started, because when the fulfillment starts, we're going to bust out of here and we're going to bust out of wherever else God puts us. Now, many of you haven't seen the promise fulfilled in your life just yet. Maybe God has called you out, but you haven't responded. Or maybe you didn't know God had promises for you. But here's what I know. I know there's a person sitting here who's struggling through a broken relationship. You don't trust promises because every promise ever made to you was broken. And there's a person here struggling with addiction. You are feeling guilt and shame, and you know that you're disappointing everybody that loves you, but you don't see a way out. You keep getting drawn back in. You don't know how to say no. You can't walk away. There's another person in here who's made bad decision after bad decision, and you wonder if God is too distant, if you've messed up too many times, if he still wants you, if he still loves you. And there's someone in here who's considered taking their own life, and today was a step in hope. Maybe I'll just show up there. Maybe I'll just show up. Let's see what God has to say to me. If that's you, or if you're feeling discouraged in any way, can you nod your head so I can know? I see you. Can you nod your head so I can know? Abraham moved out in faith. Abraham moved out in faith. I'm going to ask you to do something in faith. If you are feeling discouraged in any way, hopeless in any way, I want you to stand up with me. Come on, just stand up. You can stand up. Come on, I see you. That's right, stand up. Come on, there's more. Come on, stand up. Stand up. There we go, stand up. I've got something I want to tell you. I got something I want to say. If you're feeling worn out, this is for you. If you're feeling discouraged, this is for you. If you're feeling hopeless, this is for you. God has made specific promises to you. You are alive in Christ. That in Christ you are healed. That you are God's workmanship. That you are a new creation. That you are greatly loved by God. That you are more than a conqueror in Christ. Come on, somebody. That you have a peace that surpasses all knowledge. That you are forgiven and richly blessed. That you are delivered from the power of darkness. That you are given strength according to his glory. That in Jesus' name, evil will flee. That God has given you a spirit of power. That you are free from oppression and fear has no power over you. That in Christ, come on, you are free and redeemed and liberated. Stand up, church, come on. Stand up, church. Encourage the people that are standing next to you. Put your hand on them. Put your hand on them so they know that you are loved. You may be waiting, but God is still working. You may be feeling worn out, but the promise hasn't run out. You may be feeling worn out, but the promise hasn't run out. We have a God of limitless power. We have a God of limitless energy and promise. Do you believe that? Do you believe that? Let's sing Tongues of Fire.